Good day. Within the past few months, I've switched from using my transmitter and various receivers in the 2.4 GHz band to the 900 MHz band. Specifically, I've switched to the TBS Crossfire system. If you want to learn more about the benefits of using a 900 MHz system like Crossfire, check out this video here. And as always, links for resources, products, and free TMac FPV checklists are in the video description below for your convenience. If you're relatively new to Crossfire, or are about to make the switch to it, there's some things you need to know about its very capable telemetry. First of all, there's a lot of it, which can get confusing. Secondly, some of it's different than the 2.4 GHz receiver's telemetry we're all used to, which again, can get confusing. So today, I'm going to simplify things for you by looking at four values used to describe your control link within TBS Crossfire telemetry. I'll explain what each of these four control link telemetry values are, why you may want to use one over another, and the most efficient way of using them to indicate whether or not you'll be in danger of losing your FPV quad, multi-rotor, or fixed-wing aircraft. Although my previous Crossfire setup video is still valid, I'm also going to do a mini update to it because a few things have changed with the implementation of Betaflight 4.1 and beyond. Today, I'll use a Betaflight 4.1.1 setup on my TMac Diamondback Rattler Hybrid Micro frame build, which you can check out in this video or in the pilot's den page at tmacfpv.com. I'll finish by showing you how I've set up custom audio alerts in my Jumper T16 to let me know through these control link telemetry values that it's time to change my flight profile before I lose my quad. So if you're ready to save your quad with the correct use of TBS Crossfire control link telemetry, give the video a thumbs up below, share it with your friends, and subscribe to your TMac FPV channel, your home for your journey to better FPV fun, flights, and racing stuff. As we power up our Rattler, of course with its props off since we're inside on the workbench, the three main things I feel I need while flying FPV are FPV video, so of course I can see where I'm flying, a strong control link so I can control my quad, and power from my battery for all of the quad's components. If I lose any of those three while flying, I'm going to be in trouble. With that in mind, I've got telemetry warnings, both visual and audible, set up for two of those three.
TMac, link quality is now critical. Feeling low. TMac, bring me home.
If you're interested in learning how to create custom sounds like those, check out my video on Jumper T16 custom sounds, which includes a link to an easy-to-follow checklist for setting up your own custom sounds in its video description. You'll visually know when you're about to lose video through your goggles because it normally just doesn't drop out and go blank all of a sudden. If it does and you have GPS rescue set up, you can always just activate that to save your quad. If you're interested in learning how to set up GPS rescue, I've got a video for that as well with its own GPS rescue flowchart and setup checklist you can download through a link in its video description. The other two, your power source and control link, you can set up visual warnings in your OSD through the OSD tab in Betaflight, as well as audible warnings through your transmitter as long as you're using a telemetry receiver. Since in today's video we're talking about using TBS Crossfire, to monitor the battery voltage is fairly straightforward. You just do that with the telemetry value RXBT, which you can see here. These are all the telemetry values I'm getting from my TBS Crossfire Nano receiver. Here you see RXBT for the battery voltage, and I've got that placed on both my OSD screen in my goggles, and also as a widget value I can visually see on my transmitter prior to takeoff, which you saw previously. I've also set up an audible warning for low battery voltage.
Feeling low. TMac.
By using logical switches and special functions within OpenTX. So that covers your FPV video and battery voltage, but what about your control signal? How can we monitor that to ensure we can maintain control of our quad while in flight? Well, that's where it can get a little confusing, because there are a few telemetry values we can use. First, we could use RSSI, and with my Crossfire setup, that telemetry value is 1 RSS or 2 RSS for antenna 1 or 2, but there's also the telemetry values RQLY, and RSNR, as well as RFMD, which we could use to monitor the control link. Which one of these, or a combination of all four, should we use? See how it can get to be confusing? Let's take a closer look at all four of these, RSSI, RFMD, RSNR, and RQLY, to figure this stuff out. Let's start with RSSI, which is your received signal strength indicator. If it were sound, this would basically be how loud it is, or the volume.
When activated in your OSD, you can display it as both a percentage, 0 to 100%, or in decibels or dB. Before I go any further, now's a good time for me to explain and to make you aware that sometimes, and not just with telemetry values, the range of values for a variable within OpenTX on your transmitter and the range of that same variable within Betaflight and therefore your OSD can be different. They can use different scales, as well as the variable's units of measurement can be different. For example, in your transmitter, certain things can be measured in dB, whereas in Betaflight, those same things may be in percent. An example of different ranges would be for throttle curves, which you can check out in this Better FPV throttle control video. I just want to make sure you're aware of this fact, so later on you're not confused as to why you see one number in your transmitter and a different number in your OSD for the same variable. Per the Crossfire manual, one RSS and two RSS telemetry values are your uplink received signal strength. One thing to keep in mind with RSSI is it does not take into consideration the amount of noise or interference in your flight environment. So, an example of this is your voice in a sporting event stadium would be the equivalent of your signal, whereas the rest of the crowd's voices in the stadium would be the noise. You could be yelling something to a person at the end of your seating row, but that person may not even hear you because of the crowd noise. The fact RSSI doesn't take into account valid information packets, and I'll call these words in our analogy, means even if your friend at the end of the seating aisle could hear you, he may not be able to understand what you're saying. So keep these things in mind when considering how useful RSSI may be to you. RFMD is a crossfire telemetry value which can be the number 0, 1, or 2. This is not available in your OSD, but is a value which is accessible in your transmitter. The value indicates three different levels of update rate, where an RFMD of 2 is the fastest update rate at 150 Hz with the lowest latency between stick inputs and your quadcopter's reactions to them. An RFMD value of 1 updates at 50 Hz with more latency, yet has longer range than RFMD of 2. An RFMD of 0 only updates at 4 Hz and is used for extreme long-range flights and is only recommended for assisted flight modes using GPS. You need to ask yourself whether or not this telemetry value is of any use to you. However, I will point out here shortly when you do need to know what update rate is currently in use. RSNR is your uplink signal-to-noise ratio, which is measured in dB and is also not available in your OSD, but is available as a value within your transmitter. It does take noise into account, so back to our sports stadium analogy, it would compare the loudness of your voice to that of the overall crowd in the stadium. It does not take into consideration whether or not your friend at the end of the aisle can actually understand what you're saying. The last one is RQLY, or your uplink link quality. This is available in your OSD and is labeled as link quality as an option to enable. This takes into consideration valid information packs, or in our analogy, words. So it takes into account whether or not your friend at the end of your seating aisle can actually understand what you're saying to him. It is measured in two different ways. In your transmitter, it's measured on a scale of 0 to 100%. On your OSD, it's scaled differently. If you're in RFMD 2, your OSD value will range from 200 to 300. If your signal becomes weaker while in the normal operating mode as opposed to the forced telemetry mode, Crossfire will automatically drop into RFMD 1 update rate profile, switching from 150 Hz update rate to 50 Hz update rate, but giving you more range to work with. When using RFMD 1, your range of RQLY on your OSD will be 100 to 199. The same sort of thing could occur for RFMD 0 with a range of 0 to 99 in your OSD. The thing to keep in mind is your OSD link quality value may be displaying around 300 and all of a sudden jump down to 199 as a hypothetical example. This isn't a bad thing, it just means Crossfire has changed update rate profiles to a lower update rate. According to the Crossfire manual, you should become concerned when your RQLY value in your transmitter is at 70% and it's critical at 60%. So if I were to set up audible alarms within my transmitter, instead of having to keep an eye on a small number somewhere on my OSD, I would set up the audible alarm for an RQLY warning somewhere around 70 to 75%. So now you have an idea of what these four Crossfire telemetry values are and whether or not they may be useful to you. From my perspective, the most useful one of all four is RQLY. The other ones can go up and down, but if you've got good link quality, you're good to go. However, if your RSSI is strong and you have bad link quality, you could be in danger of a failsafe. With that in mind, I'm going to be focused on making sure my RQLY link quality value is set up properly in my transmitter for audible warnings and also in my OSD. Let's take a look how to do that. First, let's do the setup for our OSD and Betaflight, then we'll make sure we've got our warnings set up correctly in our Jumper T16. Alright, according to the Betaflight wiki, which you can find at this URL, for Betaflight 4.1 and later, which is what we're using, as mentioned in the intro to this video, we're using 4.1.1 on our Rattler, so we'll be using these steps. If you're running 4.0 or earlier, these are the steps you need to use to get LQ on an unused RC channel. So we'll be following these steps, and we connect to Betaflight, and we go to configuration, and in configuration, we want to make sure that this RSSI ADC is turned off. Keep it off. We want to make sure that we've got our receiver set up properly. In my case, I've got serial-based receiver and crossfire, which is what we're talking about today. That makes sense. Once you make any changes, you always want to make sure and save and reboot. Next, since we're again using 4.1 or later, we go to our receiver tab, and over here, where we used to have to use an aux channel, when I was using Crossfire with 12 channels activated, I would put it on aux 8, which would be channel 12. In this case, for 4.1 and later, we don't need to do that. We just make sure that that's disabled. Click Save. And then we go to our OSD, and normally I would have RSSI up here. Since we've gone over what those four Crossfire telemetry values are, I'm not concerned about RSSI anymore. I'm going to look for link quality, and I'm going to put that on my OSD. The only reason I'm clicking 3 is I've got 3 different OSD profiles. So click on link quality to put link quality on your OSD, and then of course you can drag and drop it wherever you'd like. We're going to click save. If you see some sort of strange symbol up here next to your link quality value, what that means is you haven't uploaded the latest font default for 4.1 and later for your OSD. So you just go down here to Font Manager, click Font Manager, and then upload font, and it'll upload it, the latest default font, and reboot. And with that font update, you should no longer see any strange symbol up here next to your link quality value. That's it for Betaflight. Now let's take a look at how we set up our audible alarms for a low RQLY value in our Jumper T16 transmitter.
All right, now we're going to look at how we set up our telemetry warnings in our Jumper T16 transmitter. I'm using the Rattler model here, so I'm going to press and hold this key to get into our model setup, and I'm going to scroll over to logical switches. And I've simplified things here. The only things I'm monitoring are my RF profile, which we went over, can be 0, 1, or 2. Normally it's in mode 2. I'm monitoring my RQLY, which in the transmitter runs on a 0 to 100% scale, and I'm monitoring my battery voltage. The way I've got this set up, or the way you set up logical switches, is you click on it, and then you move over to the column that you want to change, click on that, and use your scroll wheel to change that. I'm going to be using A is less than X, where A is RFMD, and the value is going to be 2 with a delay of 1 second. This column here is delays, and if when you scroll over, you can see a brief explanation of what the column is. So if I scroll over here, it says min duration. Here is AND switch. So we actually use that down here at L1. So this first logical switch 1 is when the RFMD value is going to be less than 2, so when it's 0 or 1. The second logical switch is for when the RQLY value is less than 75%. I mentioned earlier I wanted to make it somewhere between 70 and 75. I just happened to choose 75 to be on the conservative side. So the way I've set this logical switch 2 up is when my RQLY value is less than 75, and it's not in mode 2, so when my RQLY value is less than 75% in mode 0 or 1 for more than 1 second, then this logical switch will activate. The third logical switch is just to monitor my battery voltage, and that will activate when the battery voltage telemetry value, RXBT, is less than 14 volts for more than 1.5 seconds. So those are my three logical switches. Pretty simple. For our control signal telemetry, we're only concerned about logical switch 1 and 2, and we're going to play a track when our RQLY value in our transmitter is less than 75% and we're in mode 0 or 1. We go to the next page, to our special functions, and special function 1 is L2, play track, which is link low, one time, but not at startup. Special function 2 is for L3, logical switch 3, where we're going to play the track to warn us of low battery voltage, and we're going to continue to play that for 10 seconds. Special function 3 is just for my launch mode when it's activated using this switch A. So when I flip this switch,
launch mode activated. Ready to launch?
It warns me that I'm in launch mode. So when logical switch 2 is activated and my RQLY is less than 75% and I'm no longer in mode 2, then it's going to play the track that my RQLY link is low.
So that's the simple nuts and bolts of TBS Crossfire Control Link Telemetry. Let me know in the comments section below which of the four values we've gone over, or a combination of all four, seem to make sense for you to use. If you want to get more good info on FPV fun stuff, make sure to subscribe, hit that notification bell, and if you're interested in starting your journey to better FPV fun, head on over to the TMacFPV.com website for more free resources and to check out the Fast Track FPV course, Your Clear Flight Path to FPV Fun. Thanks for your time. I'll see you next video. Clear skies, friend.